Hello again, this is Ryan1908 and welcome back to my LuaSTG tutorial series. Today we're gonna put our hands in action and make our first spell card. But first of all, we have to know how to even start using the engine first, right? As I said in the last video, you can either use one of the LuaSTG editors or you can code by hand. I'm not very experienced in coding by hand yet, and also this isn't the intention of the video, so I'm just going to teach the editor way of doing things, you know? With some little tidbits of coding here and there. Anyways, in case you haven't gotten the download links from the last video, I'm going to put those down in the description box like always. Oh, and also the project file after we finish doing our first experiments, so you can compare between yours and mine. So after you finish downloading the Lua for Windows software, LuaSTG X Plus and VSharp editor, you're gonna do the following steps. You're gonna install Lua for Windows like you do with any normal application, and then you're gonna place the folders editor, game, and tools from the LuaSTG archive in one folder. I personally created a folder called tutorial and placed those inside it. Now you're gonna get the Sharp editor, create a folder named whatever you want inside that same tutorial folder. I named Turbot for me and place the Sharp contents in there. Also, create another folder besides those, there you're gonna store your project files and things related to your game. I named mine as project. After you have done that, you're gonna open the Sharp editor and do the following steps. Open it, then go to settings, then compiler settings, then click on LuaSTG executable path. Locate the LuaSTG executable in the game folder, then click OK, and then call Sharp. Open it again and go to general settings, then select the plugin called luastgxlib.legacy.dll. Then you click OK again and close Sharp. Open it again, then go to general settings, select the plugin luastgpluslib.dll, close it again and open it yet again. Finally, it'll be ready for us to use. Make sure that there's no error recorded in the message box in the bottom of the editor, and let's proceed. Okay, so now let's finally create our first project, shall we? Click on the new file button on the top left corner of the editor, and then template section pop-up will appear. 5 templates can be chosen to use as a new file. Clicking on them will show a description of each in this right side of the window. Let's start using this poker template. Give a name to your project. I personally named mine Tutorial 2 and also put your name in the box below. There are 2 buttons that describe Allow Practice and Allow SC Practice. They are the options you can mark or unmark to enable or disable stage practice or spell card practice, respectively. I'll let them enable, but don't worry, in case you change your mind, you can disable or enable them later. So yeah, click on that OK button and let the magic happen. Our management field has been filled with some default nodes and we are kind of ready to try playing it. But first, save your project file using the save button on the top left corner, or if the button is blocked or you can press it, you can also go to the file and then save it as. You can save it in that folder that we created just for that in the beginning, and in my case, project. Now click on the run project button and let's see what happens. Oh, and if the game crashes to you when you open it, go to settings, then debug settings and change the resolution of the game. I had to do that as well. As you can see, when entering the game, a ball of light appeared and this stood there, but it worked flawlessly and everything was fine. This is the difference of LuaSTG compared to alternatives like Demakifu, as the game already starts with working assets and you can just very easily create stages or bosses since a default system already comes in place. Of course, in case you don't like it or you prefer changing, you can also do that later, however, I'm not gonna cover that today as it's kind of out of our scope. Anyway, let me explain more details what happened. First, click on the Define Boss node and look at the Parameter tab. You can see that you can already change some things clicking on each node. In this case, the properties are Name, which is the name of the boss that is referred to inside the engine for calculation purposes. Difficulty, which is the difficulty the boss belongs to. It's currently in all because we don't have any set difficulty yet, so this boss will appear in all difficulties. There's also the displayed name, which is the name of the boss that will be shown on the top left corner of the playing field in-game. Background, which will be what background the boss will be inside the spell card practice. And background music, which is the same thing as the previous one, except for music. Now, by default, those two are the Banfield Forest of the Lost and the Imperishable Knight spell card theme. I personally named mine as the boss name Marissa, and the display name as Marissa Kirisami. Next, we have the onInit node. This node's parameters are position and spell card background. But before we proceed, I have something to point out. The onInit node isn't exclusive to the boss defined node, but it is rather present on a multitude of other nodes, and its function is to determine arguments to be given to said nodes when they're created. It also has some other siblings, such as onframe, kill, del, collide, start, and finish. Each of them having separate functions and can have different usages depending on what the node they belong to is. Anyway, coming back to the onInit of the defined boss node, there it has a function of determining the position of the boss when it is created, and what is the spell background of it, just like in the official games where the background changes once you declare a spell card. For now, don't change anything on this. Then we have the spell card node. This one is pretty important, so pay attention. In the parameter list, we have name, which is the spell card name, protect time, which will be how much times the boss will be invincible in the beginning, damage reduce time, which is how long it takes for the boss to gradually take more damage over time, and the total amount of time in the spell. To make a timeout spell card, just make those three values the same number. Immune to bomb means exactly what it says. If the boss is immune to bomb in the spell card, there is hit point as well, which is the amount of health the spell card has. After that, draw, power, faith, and point, which is self-explanatory. Those make their respective items fall in the quantity that you want. And then those last two are kind of complicated. They're more complex than what I'm gonna teach in this tutorial series, so don't touch them for now. And finally, if you want to create a non-spell, just erase the spell card name and it will turn into a non. And so these are the three main components of the boss farm. However, of course, we're gonna add more to it. Now, how about we give a more decent look to our boss? There's a reason as to why I named the boss as Marissa. I'll be leaving a sample sprite work of her in the description so that you can use as a base to define your boss's sprite. Once you download it, extract the files inside your project folder. I personally created another folder inside it called resources and place it there. You'll also notice there are other files in there, but we'll take care of them later. Remember that last time when I explained how you inserted nodes in the editor? Well, in case you don't remember, use the insert buttons on the top of the editor. Anyways, let's give Mars his sprite to the boss. Select the onInit node of the boss node and place the set walk image of an object node from the boss tab as in child of it. A window will pop up. Go to the folder you placed the Marissa sprite and select it. Now, as you can see, there are some properties to this node. Image path that describes where the image is located. Columns and rows, which is the amount of columns and rows in the sprite. In this case, 4 columns and 3 rows. Then we have number of images, which is to check if there really is the amount of sprite images in these columns and rows based on a simple calculation. However, since our sprite only has 3 sprite images in the last row, we'll change the number of images to 4, 4, and 3. Don't touch the number of repetent yet, as it's a bit out of scope for us. I'll explain what it does later. Animation interval, which is self-explanatory, describes the amount of frames between each image sprite changes to the next one. And finally, collision size, which is the amount of pixels starting from the middle of the boss that will be the hitbox run. In this case, a circle. Now let's try running the game and see what happens. If the game crashes for you, remember that since we changed the boss name to something different from the default, we have to expand the stage group node and change the create boss node to the name of our new boss. Nice, it works! Now, to the fun part. Let's try making some bullets. Select the Move To node that is inside of the spell card, go to the Bullet tab and select Create a Simple Bullets. Remember to place it after the Move To, otherwise the boss will only appear if it has already shot those bullets. In this node, we can see that it has a lot of parameters, so let's see what each of those do. In style, you can select what is the graphic of the bullet that you want. In color, you change its color. The position is where they're going to spawn. Here it says self X and self Y. In this case, the self is referring to the bot, since the node is inside of the spell card. Number is the amount of bullets that will be shot. Interval is the amount of time between the bullets are shot. However, I do not recommend using this as it can lead to bugs. Velocity begin is the velocity from the first bullet shot, and the velocity end is the velocity from the last bullet shot. Make these values equal if you want the bullets to be all in the same speed. Angle is the angle of the bullets that are shot. In LuaSTG, the angle 0 is pointing directly to the right, so 90 degrees would be pointing to the top. Angle spread is basically the radius of the bullet shot. If it's 360, the bullet will be shot in equal angles between themselves to form a circle. If it's 0, then they'll be shot in a single line, and so on. Aim to player is a true or false check that you can determine if the bullet will be aimed to the player. Remember to put angle to 0 if you enable this, otherwise the angle will be off and will be calculated relative to the player's position. Rotation velocity is the bullet graphics spinning animation. This is useful, for example, in Marissa's stars spinning. This doesn't change the angle though. Stay on crate means that the bullet will not execute its action until their spawn effect ends. And then we have the destroyable property, which is to define if the bullet can be erased by using, for example, bombs. The time is the amount of frames that the bullet will wait before moving itself. And finally, rebound defines if the bullet will get off of the borders of the playing field. However, they will only bounce once and they don't bounce off from the bottom. This is also a good time to introduce RNG, which is a net random number generator. For example, if you type ran int 1 to 3, the RNG will select a number between 1 and 5 and also include them. There are two types of RNG, int and float. Int only uses full numbers like 1, 2, and 3. Float can use decimals like 1.1, 1.2, 1.3, etc. Anyway, I'll do my bullet properties now. In my case, I will do a full circle of stars. I want their color to be random, so I will use the ran int 1 to 16 in the color parameter, since there are 16 bullet colors. And RNG will pick a random color to use in the stars. I will also make the angle random. I'll use ran float 0 to 260 so that it selects any angle that it wants. I didn't use float in the color parameter because it only accepts integers, but here in the angle it accepts both. I'll also make my rotation velocity random, and in the end my node look like this. Let's try testing it. As you can see, it worked. However, it only did it once. That's because we didn't tell it repeat action. To do that, create a task repeat node from the task tab as a parent of the bullet node. Then two things will spawn, the repeater and the wait node. Make sure to make it that the wait node is after your bullets. You can decrease or increase the interval of the bullets changing that wait node. I personally told it to wait 10 frames before repeating. As for the repeat node, underscore infinite just means that the boss will forever repeat the action, and if you wanted to only repeat it, for example, 10 times, just type 10 times in it. Let's try playing. Anyways, it worked. Also, I completely forgot to make the colors random when I was recording this, lol, but it works. And so, we reached the end of this tutorial. I was actually planning to show much more, but when I finished writing the script, I noticed how much I had already talked, just explaining some simple parts of it. So hopefully next time I'll have more time to do more things, you know, like adding sounds, creating a background for a spell card, and so on. But for now, I still have to edit this and publish it still today, so yeah. Thanks for watching, and I hope you understood more of the engine. As always, if you have any questions, please join the Bullet Hell Engine's Discord server. That's the best place to get support, and I am there as well, and so are other LuaSTG users that are really willing to help you. So, for now, farewell. Thanks for watching again. See you next time.